Well, hello everybody, and welcome once again to this special time in God's Word, and a special welcome to all of you at JCCMI, Jesus Christ Centered Ministries International, located right here in Nassau, Bahamas. We are right now sharing this time together in God's Word here on Sunday, the 22nd of March, 2020, the year of the double. And as you know, the Lord has given us a word for this year, a word that we've been speaking concerning from Watch Night, concerning the year of the double. Interestingly enough, as you know, many others have been receiving the same word from the Lord. And so it is a word that has been confirmed. It is the year of vision. It is the year of increase. It is the year of the double. In the light of things that are going on in the world, of course, you know, in the world system, there is a virus that is being going on throughout the world. And we want to remember that in the midst of what is going on in the world, in the midst of the things that the enemy is trying to do, we have divine protection. Psalm 91 tells us in verse 10 and 11, which JCCMI members you should be speaking and confessing every day. The Bible says, no evil shall befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge concerning thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. You should be keeping that word of God in you at all times, in your heart and in your mouth, and saying, no evil befalls me, neither does any plague come nigh my dwelling. For God gives his angels charge concerning me, to keep me and my family in all our ways. I also wanted to read to you something that I believe will be encouraging to you from Isaiah chapter 60, and it says, in beginning from verse 1, arise and shine, arise, shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness the people. But the Lord shall arise upon thee, and his light shall be seen on thee, or upon thee. So I wanted to encourage you with that, that even in the midst of what the enemy is trying to push and say, when he's trying to say things are getting worse and things are getting bad, I want you to know that even in the midst of this darkness, God's light is rising upon his people. Amen. And so he said, behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, gross darkness the people, but the Lord shall arise upon thee, his people, and his glory shall be seen upon thee. Amen. So keep in mind that this virus will not last. It will pass very quickly because the people of God have been praying. The people of God have been speaking to it and speaking at it, commanding it to go in Jesus' name. And that virus and the spirit of fear has no choice. So we thank God for his word, and we thank God that the church has authority in the earth in the name of the Lord Jesus to command the forces of darkness to back up. And that's exactly what we have been doing. So we thank God that we have this opportunity to feed on his word. In the book of Isaiah, the 61st chapter, this is the word of the Lord that was given to us from Watch Night, and we have been feeding upon this. Again, this is where the Lord Jesus, in speaking concerning the purpose of his ministry, this is what he quoted from. He quoted from it according to Luke, the 4th chapter, beginning from the 16th, I believe, the 14th verse thereabout. And it said that he found the place where it was written in the book of Isaiah, and he began to quote the first and second parts of this particular chapter. However, we went further into looking into Isaiah and looking and seeing many of the things that the Spirit of the Lord came upon and anointed the Lord Jesus Christ to do. He is the Christ, the Anointed One. So he says here, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord had anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He had sent me to heal or bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion. And thank God, Zion is the church. All right. According to Hebrews chapter 12, verse 22, Zion, while in the Old Covenant referred to the nation of Israel, the Jews, Zion also is the church. We are spiritual Zion. We are the people of God. So he says, to give unto them that mourn, to give unto them beauty for ashes. And this is what God wants to do. He wants to take the destroyed areas of your life and give you beauty for those areas that have been destroyed. And then it says to give you the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Hallelujah. And so we talked about this in some detail. God wants us to praise him. God wants us to learn how to worship him in the midst of whatever it is we may be going through. He wants us to put on the garment of praise and refuse to let depression, refuse to let any kind of oppression get on us. Listen, complaining and worrying and fretting will not bring you out of the situation that you may be facing. This is why you need to learn to praise God. You need to learn to thank him, to worship him, to glorify him, and to hold fast to his promises. So in his word, he tells us here that he has given us the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. If you feel any heaviness, any weight coming down at you, learn how to praise God. Learn how to lift your hands in the midst of what you're going through. Focus on the Lord. Focus on his promises. Focus on his word and give God glory. Give God thanks. In the midst of what Abraham was going through, he gave glory to God. And the Bible said he became strong in faith, giving glory to God. So no situation you face, no struggle you face, no challenge you face, no problem you face is bigger than God. God is able to help you. God is able to bring you through anything that you may be struggling with, dealing with. God is able to meet your every need. He's able to supply your every heart's desire. He's able to heal your body from any sickness, from any disease. God is your answer. And so learn how to praise him, learn how to worship him, and learn how to give God glory. Then he says that they may be called, might be called trees of righteousness. And I like again how the Amplified Bible says oaks of righteousness, because you know, if it's just any tree, then a wind or a storm make it just blow it down. But an oak speaks of a very strong tree that carries its roots down deep and wraps them around a rock, you know, and that tree is very difficult for a storm to blow down. And so God calls us trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified. And then it said, they shall build the old waste places, they shall raise up the former desolations, and they shall repair the waste cities, the desolations of many generations. And of course, this has a twofold meaning. Of course, on one end, it's speaking of God's restoration of the nation of Israel. But I believe there's also spiritual meaning in this. And these are things that the body of Christ can believe for, because God is coming to our lives. Christ is coming to our lives to literally give us life and to give us life more abundantly, John 10:10. And so he wants to do this for your life. He wants to give you the power to build the oil waste places and raise up former desolation, former places of your life that is being destroyed. The Bible says that the Lord will give you the power to go ahead and repair those places and to repair the waste cities, the desolations of many generations. Listen, Jesus comes into our lives, and if we yield to him, and if we learn to obey him, and we learn to flow with him, he makes our lives better. All we need to do is trust in him, trust in his word, walk in obedience to his word, stay with his word, and he will make our lives better. I'm telling you, it's just a privilege and an honor to serve the Lord. Then he says here, but strangers shall stand and feed your flocks, and the sons of the aliens or the Gentiles shall be your plowmen and your wine dressers. But you shall be named the priests of the Lord. And if you notice in the New Testament, the Bible says in Revelation chapter 1, verse 5 and 6, that we are kings and priests unto God. Men shall call you ministers of our God. You shall eat the riches of the Gentiles, and in their glory shall you boast yourselves. Then the verse that we want to get to, verse number 7. It says, for your shame you shall have double, and for confusion they shall rejoice in their portion. Therefore, in their land they shall possess the double. Everlasting joy, hallelujah, shall be unto them. Now, let me read that to you out of the Amplified Bible, and it just amplifies it. Notice here in the Amplified Bible of Isaiah chapter 61 and verse 7, it says, instead of your former shame, you shall have a twofold recompense. That's a twofold payback, praise God. Instead of dishonor and reproach, your people shall rejoice in their portion. Therefore, in their land, they shall possess double what they had forfeited, double what should have been yours. Everlasting joy shall be unto them. So we notice here now that these benefits, these blessings that we in Christ can receive, hallelujah, are all because of the anointing. Jesus, the anointed one, is anointed to do these things and bring these things into our lives. And so that's why he started off by saying, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he had anointed me. He has anointed me to do these things. And so we can receive from the Lord through his anointing in these various areas of our lives. And one of these things that we can receive is double blessing. Double blessing, double recompense, double payback for all of the trouble, all of the struggles you've been through. God wants to give you double for your trouble. Now you have to believe that. You have to believe that God loves you and that God wants the best for you. You have to believe that every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and come from the Father of lights, with whom there is no shadow of turning. Amen. You have to believe that. You have to believe that he loves you and he wants the best for you. All right. So we began talking concerning the anointing, and we have already stated several different things that we just want to do a quick recap about as we move on in to understanding how to tap into the blessings that God has provided, how to tap into the various things that he has provided for his children. And one of the things that we found out is that the anointing, when the Bible said Jesus is anointed, was anointed by the Holy Spirit. Well, hello everybody, and is here in every believer. In every believer, he is here to do a work. He is here to actually bring all that has been promised to us in the new covenant, the covenant sealed by the blood of Jesus Christ. He is here to bring these things and make them a living reality in our lives. He is here to manifest the very goodness of God in our lives. He's here to, as our seal, of course, until the day of redemption, but he's also here to bring to pass what God has promised us. And so we need to learn how to listen to the anointing. The Bible says in the book of 1 John chapter 2 and verse 20, but you have an unction from the Holy One, and you know all things. Verse 27 of 1 John chapter 2 says, but the anointing which you have received of him abides in you, and you need not that any man teach you, but as the same anointing teacheth you of all things to the truth, and is no lie, even as it hath taught you, you shall abide in him. Now, when John was saying this, of course, to the believers in the book of 1 John, he was speaking, if you read from chapter 2, verse 18, concerning those that were trying to seduce and deceive them with error and wrong doctrine. However, those believers had already been taught the foundational principles of the doctrine of Christ. They had already been taught the word. And if you read from verse 18 straight down to 27, you'll see where John said that he wasn't writing to them because they didn't know. He said, because you've already been taught these things. You already know these things, you see. And because they already had been taught them, John was letting them know that they could trust that the anointing that was on the inside, the anointing of the Holy Spirit, the person of the Holy Spirit who lived within them would bring back to them the things that they had been taught to show them when error was being presented to them so they could avoid the error. Hallelujah. So we have the anointing of God in us. We have the Spirit of the living God on the inside of us. And the Bible speaks of the anointing of God in the book of Revelation chapter 1, verses 4 and 5. And it calls him the seven spirits of God. Now, they are not seven Holy Spirits. There's only one Holy Spirit. But he was speaking of the sevenfold aspects or the sevenfold operation of the Spirit of God. And then in the book of Revelation chapter 5, we already looked at this. The Bible speaks of Jesus, the Lamb of God, the only one who is worthy. And the Bible speaks of him having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth. Now, what is he referring to here? When you speak of the horn, if you remember, the ram's horn was used to pour olive oil in, and this was what the priests would carry, and the priest or the prophet would anoint people with the oil from that ram's horn. So Jesus being referred to as the one who has the seven horns, it refers to the fact that he is, of course, the anointed one, but the Holy Spirit has an anointing, a sevenfold anointing that believers are able to tap into. Glory to God. Hallelujah. And then you talk about seven eyes of the Spirit. And the seven eyes of the Spirit here refer to the fact that the Holy Spirit is able to give us sight beyond sight, cause us to see beyond what other people see and know beyond what other people know, give us spiritual wisdom and revelation and insight and foresight. Amen. And knowledge that other people who are not in the Word of God, who do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ, may not and would not be able to tap into. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, 14, the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for he cannot know them. He said they're foolishness to him. He cannot know them because they are spiritually discerned. This means that the true child of God is able to tap into the wisdom of God and into the mind of Christ, the anointed one, and know things supernaturally, know things by the scriptures, know things by the Spirit of God that people who are not born again will not know. And so we need to learn how to tap into the Spirit of God and tap into the sevenfold working or operation of the Spirit of God. Well, what are those sevenfold operations? I'm glad you asked. They are found there again in Isaiah chapter number 11. Isaiah chapter number 11. And where it says, verse 1 and 2, and there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse. Of course, this is a prophecy of the Lord Jesus Christ himself. There shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. And what will this anointing of the Spirit of God do? Shall make him of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord, and he shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears, but with righteousness shall he judge the poor, and reprove with equity, and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth, and he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked. And of course, some of this is referring to when Christ comes again in his millennial reign, the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. So, but go back up there and you'll see the sevenfold operation of the Spirit of God. He said, the Spirit of the Lord, verse 2, shall come upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. Now, when I one time ago heard this message and heard others teach on this, I was reading Isaiah and I kept asking, I said, I see six. I don't see seven things that the Holy Spirit would do. I see six things here, six attributes, six operations. I don't see number seven. And so I read it again. And then after I think I read it about two or three times, and all of a sudden I saw it. But here it is. It says, the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge, and of the fear of the Lord. Now someone says, I still see six. Yeah, because you're counting the spirit of wisdom as number one. The first one is actually the spirit of the Lord. And this shows us that the Holy Spirit has come to bring glory to God. He has come to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. He's not come to glorify himself. He's come to glorify Christ. And so that is vitally important when talking about the ministry of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, whatever he does, whatever he says, it's all for the purpose of bringing glory to the name of Jesus. Now, if you keep that in mind, you won't ever allow yourself to go astray when it comes to operating in operations or gifts of the Spirit, or in operating and saying that you're speaking prophetically. True prophecy. The Bible says that the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. All true prophecies find their root in the Lord Jesus Christ. All true ministry of the Spirit find their root in the Lord Jesus Christ. And I hope that you understand that. I hope that that is clear. And I hope that we adhere to that. That the Holy Spirit is here to bring glory to the name of Jesus. Now we started to talk about number two. He is the Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of wisdom. The Spirit of wisdom. And if you remember, those of you from Jesus Christ Centered Ministries International, we went into the book of Proverbs, chapter number 9, because now we're looking at wisdom. He is the spirit of wisdom. The Holy Spirit has come to give us wisdom. Now, we said already, wisdom is God's supernatural ability to succeed in any area of life. All right? Wisdom is the key to success in any area of life. One of the key words for wisdom in the Old Testament is the Hebrew word chokmah, and in the New Testament, it's the Greek word sophia. It actually means skill. It means insight. Knowledge is the accumulation of facts or truth. Understanding is the interpretation of facts or truth. Wisdom is the application of facts or truth. Okay, wisdom has to do with the ability, the God-given ability to apply knowledge to get a successful or victorious result. All right, so the wisdom of God is what we're looking at. Now, in the book of Proverbs chapter 9, very interesting verse of scripture here, beginning at verse 1, it said, wisdom had builded her house, she had hewn out her seven pillars. Now, when we looked at this, one of the things that we wanted to state again is that when you think of a pillar, especially back there when this was written, pillars were used to help keep a house up. Pillars were placed in a house or in a big auditorium in order to help support the weight of the roof of that particular structure. And so when we talk of the pillars here, wisdom having seven pillars, it means that wisdom is able to give strength and stability to your life, so that even when the storms of life come, even when the rain fall and the winds blow and the hurricanes come, your house, your spiritual life, your life in God is able to stand. And so he says here that wisdom had hewn out her seven pillars. And I said to you that all of the book of Proverbs can actually be brought down into an understanding of the seven pillars of wisdom. Amen. So let me give you these seven pillars again real quickly, and then we'll go back to the first pillar one more time. And these seven pillars from which the entire book of Proverbs can be seen in the light of these seven pillars. These seven pillars are number one, fear God, the fear of the Lord. Number two, watch your company. Number three, get knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. Number four, learn the principle of work. Learn and understand the principle of work. Work is not a dirty or a bad word, by the way. Number five, learn the principle concerning sexual purity and in marriage, sexual enjoyment. Number six, the family principle. Learn the principle of family life, how family is supposed to operate in line with God's particular standard and way of doing things. And number seven, the mouth principle. And the mouth principle speaks of learning how to talk, what to say, and so forth. And so if you've read through the book of Proverbs before, I've read through the book of Proverbs 50 times back to back. If you've read through them, because there's still a lot in there I don't know yet, there's still a lot in there I'm learning. But if you read it before and your mind is focused on what the book is saying, you'll see that these seven principles, what I just gave, these seven pillars, actually take in all of what the book of Proverbs is actually about. All right? So the first one that we actually started to deal with was the fear of the Lord. The word, when we talk about fearing God, it actually means three things. It means to respect God, it means to revere God, is here in, and it means to obey God. To fear God means to respect Him. It means to revere or to worship Him, to reverence Him, to worship Him. You know, in the book of Proverbs chapter, I mean Psalm chapter 34 verse 7, it says the angel of the Lord encamps around about those that fear Him and delivers them. Then in the book of Deuteronomy, before we go to Deuteronomy, go back to Matthew, when Jesus was being tempted by Satan in Matthew chapter 4 verses 1 to 11. The Bible says that Satan tried to get Jesus to bow down to him, and Jesus said the words, it is written. He was rebuking the devil, and he said, it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Well, if you go back and see where that was written, it was written in the book of Deuteronomy. I'm thinking it's chapter 6, but it was written there, and instead of it using worship there, it used the word fear. So Jesus, in essence, was saying that to fear God is to worship God. And so we see that fearing Him has to do with respecting Him. Fearing Him has to do with reverencing or worshiping Him, living a life of worship to the Lord. Worship, living a life of worship is more than just being a part of a worship service and just saying, okay, let's spend about half an hour to an hour just jumping up and down saying we're worshiping the Lord. That's a part of it. But having a life of worship to the Lord is something that you practice day in and day out, where you're in a constant state of giving God thanks, giving God praise, giving God glory, and where you're in a constant state of remembering that you serve the Lord Christ, that you are, you belong to Him, your whole life belongs to Him, and therefore you're aiming to live in a manner that pleases the Lord. And then he says to obey God. That's what worship means. It means when he says that we should fear the Lord, we are to obey God. All right? There are a lot of people who say, but I fear the Lord, I fear the Lord, but they will not walk in obedience to Him. True people who walk in obedience to God, who walk, really fear the Lord, walk in obedience to Him. And so we started to get into talking concerning several different things that we needed to note regarding fearing the Lord. We found out that the fear of the Lord, according to Proverbs chapter 1, verse 7, is the beginning of knowledge. When you fear God, that's when you actually begin to know something. Until you start fearing Him, you really don't know much. I don't care how much schooling you've done, where you've been, or any of that, how educated you are. Until you start to fear the Lord, you really don't know much. You really don't know much of what is going on until you start to fear the Lord. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Then we saw in Proverbs chapter 9, verse 10, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So what is God saying there? He's saying when you start to fear God, that's when you begin to be wise. All right? So if you don't fear God, you're not wise. You're not being wise. And I just wanted to get that over to you, that you need to learn how to reverence Him. You need to learn how to respect Him. And you need to learn how to obey Him. You know, Solomon, who many regard as the wisest man who ever lived, but I regard as the wisest man who lived until the time of Christ. Because Jesus, when He came, He spoke of Himself saying that a greater than Solomon is here. After all, Solomon got his wisdom from the Lord. But Solomon may have been the wisest man who ever lived up to this, that time, but Solomon died a fool, because Solomon did not heed his own wisdom. As a part of my, in the book of Proverbs, as a matter of fact, he constantly talked about the dangers of adultery. And yet Solomon had 700 wives and concubines. And God had warned him that if he fooled around with heathen women, they'd turn his heart. And Solomon didn't listen to that. And they did. They turned his heart away from God. And God did not like it. If you read the story, you'll find out that God even took some of the people away from the tribe of Judah. They separated two tribes from 10 tribes, all because of what Solomon had done. Well, Solomon wrote the book of Ecclesiastes, and if you read the book of Ecclesiastes carefully, you'll see that one of the big things he was stressing was how vanity, I mean how empty life is without serving God. And he said, vanity of vanity, all is a vanity, or empty, everything's so empty, worthless, not worthwhile, you know, not valuable. Because he tried all kinds of things. He tried women, he tried wine, drinking, he tried partying all the time. He tried just having things, material things, and he found something out. He found out that if without God, those things really don't matter. As a matter of fact, he ended the book by saying, you want to hear the conclusion of the whole matter? Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God, fear God, fear God. Reverence him, respect him, worship him, obey him, keep his commandments. You see, he came to the conclusion that in the end, that's what's really going to matter. In the end, what's going to matter is if you fear the Lord. Now, we want to look at Job again. If you remember, we looked at Job, JCCMI, Job chapter 28 and verse 28. And it says there, the fear of the Lord, he said, that is wisdom. So it's not just wise to fear the Lord. He said, when you fear the Lord, he said, that is wisdom. Amen. So that's something to take note of. So let me give you just a few more of the things that we said already, but they're things that are worth repeating. In the book of Psalm 112, he says, praise ye the Lord. Blessed is the man that feareth the Lord, that delights greatly in his commandments. Well, what are some of the benefits of fearing the Lord? His seed shall be mighty upon the earth. The generation of the upright shall be blessed. Wealth and riches shall be in his house, and his righteousness endures forever. God says when you fear him, he'll even bless you with wealth and riches. He has no problem with his people having wealth and riches. He has a problem with wealth and riches having his people. But when you fear the Lord, that means you have things in the right place. You're not a kind of person who would do anything for money. You serve God, and God blesses you with wealth. He gives you wisdom to produce wealth, wisdom to create wealth, wisdom to get wealth. This is what he said then, Deuteronomy, the 8th chapter and the 18th verse. But thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for it is he that giveth thee power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant as he promised to our fathers, as it is this day. So God desires us to be blessed. He desires us to be prosperous. And if we learn how to fear him, he will give us the wisdom to get wealth and riches. Wealth and riches will be in our house, our family, our children, our seed would be blessed. In Psalm 128, notice Psalm 128 now. He says there, praise the Lord. Psalm 128, beginning here at verse number 1, he says, blessed is everyone that feareth the Lord, that walks in his ways. Well, what will be the blessing? What will one get? What will one get? Before we hurry on to that, I wanted you to see what he called fearing the Lord. He said, blessed is everyone that feareth the Lord. What is that? What is that? That walketh in his ways. See, that's walking in the path of obedience. He says, for thou shalt eat the labor of your own hands. Happy shalt thou be. You know, a lot of people aren't happy. Are you happy? God says, if you learn how to fear him and walk in his ways, he said, you'll eat the labor of your own hands. Happy shall you be, and it shall be well with thee. I love that. Then it goes further. He says, and your wife shall be as a fruitful vine by the sides of your house. Thy children as like olive plants round about thy table. Behold, that thus shall the man be blessed that feareth the Lord. It is interesting here that God says the fear of the Lord in your life will carry over into all the other areas of your life that are important to you. When you decide to walk in His ways, when you decide to respect Him, to worship and reverence and revere Him, to obey Him and to walk in obedience to Him, God said it'll have an impact, a glorious impact, not just on your life, not just on whatever you put in your hands to do being blessed, but it'll have an impact on your family as well. Your seed, according to Psalm 112, will be blessed. Right here tells you your wife will be I'm so beautiful. Her life will be beautiful. It'll be like how when your beautiful plants, that vines that run upon your house with flowers on it, it's saying how your wife will be beautiful and life will be beautiful. Your children will be like all the plants around about your table. Their lives will be beautiful. God wants our homes beautiful. He wants our homes to be havens of peace, hallelujah, and joy. And so he desires for us to have life and have it more abundantly in every area of our lives. In every area of our lives. And all of these things are regarding the fear of the Lord. Let me give you one more. In the book of Proverbs, chapter number 19. I love this one. This is so precious when I first found it. And of course, you know, there's some scriptures I take them, they're mine, you know. But of course, if they're in the Word of God, they belong to all of us. It says in Proverbs 19, and look there at verse number, let me make sure I get this verse right, verse number 23. It says, the fear of the Lord leads to life, and he that had it shall abide satisfied. He shall not be visited with evil. Glory to God. That's awesome. The fear of the Lord leads to life, and he that had it shall abide satisfied. He shall not be visited with evil. So my brothers and my sisters, it's important that we learn to reverence God, to fear God. The Bible said if we do, he said we will abide satisfied. Do you know what it is to have a life that is just so peaceful that you're satisfied, that you're happy? That regardless of what's going on, you're content, that you're living fulfilled, that you're living full of joy, and that things are always working out in your favor. Glory to God. Hallelujah. That's an awesome thing. The fear of the Lord, according to Proverbs 34:7, will also cause you to have divine protection. The angel of the Lord encamps round about them that fear him. And delivers them. So you can believe God, if you fear God, if you reverence him, if you love him, if you worship him, you can believe God for divine protection. All of this is available when a person fears the Lord. There's so much more that can be given, so much more that we can learn on the fear of the Lord. But this is enough for you to take and feed on and chew on and enjoy. And learn the importance of fearing God. The Bible tells us in the book of Psalm, and I'd like to read that to you because I quote it at times, but sometimes we make it quoting because people don't really realize that it's really you saying what is actually in the Bible. In the book of Psalm 34, the psalmist David here says something so powerful when he says in verse number 11, come you children, hearken unto me, I will teach you the fear of the Lord. So the fear of the Lord can be taught. We can be taught how to reverence God, how to respect God, how to worship God, how to obey God, how to walk in His ways. We can be taught it. And this is what I'm doing now. I'm sharing with you things that I hope would be prompting you and getting you determined that you're going to walk in God's ways. Do things God's ways. Love God with all your heart, your mind, your soul, your strength. And love your neighbors, yourself, of course, is what the scripture teaches. And he says, come and I'll teach you the fear of the Lord. We can teach our children to fear God. I know when I was coming up as a child, I didn't have no choice in regard to going to church. I had a choice. I mean, I had a choice whether I was going to go crying or whether I was going to go happy. But I didn't have a choice as to whether I was going to go to church. These days, there are many parents who give their children choices. You shouldn't give your child a choice when it comes to going to church. Not when your child is under the age of accountability. You let them know you're going to church. You're going to learn how to reverence God. You're going to learn how to worship God. You're going to learn how to serve God. You're going to learn how to walk in God's ways. You're going to learn how God is a healer, how God is a deliverer, how God will protect you, how God will provide for you, how living for God is the best way to live. You're going to church to learn the ways of God. And so David said, come and I'll teach you the fear of the Lord. And then if you read on, he says here, what man is there that desireth? What man is he that desireth to love life, desireth life? Let me read it again. What man is he that desireth life and loveth many days that he may see good? He said, keep your tongue from evil, your lips from speaking guile. Depart from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. Why? The eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears are open unto their cry. The face of the Lord is against them that do evil, to cut off the remembrance of them from the earth. So in fearing God, we learn that God will even bless us with long life, with longevity. The Bible says with long life, he wants to satisfy us and show us his salvation. I trust that this was a blessing to you. I trust that you got something from it. Please take it and feed on it some more. Share it. Go ahead and share it with your loved ones and so forth. And fear the Lord. Reverence him. Worship him. Obey him. Let's walk in his ways. And let's experience all the blessings our Father has for us. God bless you. Until next time.